So at a high level, really we have our smart metering solution, which throw off power outage notification in the event of a power outage, obviously. That goes down through an initial filter in our ESB. This is where our filters primarily have been implemented, to remove duplicate down messages. So this is where we may get, given the random nature and within a certain time window of getting multiple messages sent from a meter, we may get duplicates. We may get a momentary where we get multiple power outage notifications within a small window where the power's gone down, come back, gone down, come back. As well as we have a fairly large set of our population where there is a switch that the user can disconnect power, but that's ahead of the meter. So this is in situations where there's irrigation accounts, where there's seasonal watering, or in some of our large apartment multi-dwelling units where the property manager or other electricians can disconnect that switch when they have to do service work. So at a high level, we implemented a number of filters, including a large-scale volume reducer as well. So in the case of storms, we wanted to be able to have the capability to control, if not eliminate, the flood of messages that go into our OMS. We were able to do extensive testing of the ESB from a test bench perspective, but it's hard to really simulate a full-scale storm, regardless of the technology, at least the technology we have from a test perspective, without getting to get real-world experience. Meter simulations and event simulations are one thing, but to have that real-world experience around what's going to happen in the middle of a storm, and we don't want to negatively impact the existing business process by this flood of information coming in until we get more experience. So as I mentioned, the filtering process is fairly straightforward. It's got multiple layers of logic, but really it relates a PON or a PRN to a meter, but we also then relate it to a transformer. We use a common SIM model for our network topology in the field. We relate a meter to a transformer to see if it's a single out or not. And if it's a single out, then we assume for now that it's a relatively high probability that's not a distribution issue if it's a single customer that we've got a message for. Obviously needs to do a few more steps to validate that if required. But if we get multiple outage notifications, then it's probably something we may be interested in. Step two is where we have a delayed window where we accumulate these messages so we don't react immediately. And this is a configurable item because we need to understand the behavior of both the metering solution and the business logic as it evolves over time. We wait a specified period and say, okay, look, at the end of this period, what duplicates have we removed? What momentaries have we removed? What have we been able to identify from a cold style, meaning those customer-operated switches, that there may be a different problem that we don't necessarily need to act on right now. We may need to do additional information. Do we want to create a double dispatch order right now or not? We go through these steps first. And then we also single out customers where it's a single PON on a transformer serving multiple customers. So what that means is obviously a transformer with 8, 10, 12 customers, if we only get one PON, then again, that's unlikely that it's a utility issue. Once we've done all that, we send those to the outage management system, and then that will be presented to the dispatcher for their information. We do send all restoration notices, though, because that helps with the restoration process, and they can display that information. For phase two, we'll build on that framework from phase one, and we want to confirm that there's power at the meter, or process for guaranteeing a response time. So as I mentioned before, when you're pinging or load-side voltage checking a meter, there's inherent latency in the network. There's a number of other issues that may arise where you may not get a response. We want to make sure that from a dispatcher operator perspective, they have some response, whether it times out or they get the value back. But we can set a configurable time period where they're not waiting for a long period and then getting nothing back or some mysterious code. We want to try and augment that logic so they can take some action or inaction depending on what they receive. We want to be able to get the actual voltage reading from the meter, again, the load side voltage check, in addition to just a power check, which is more like a standard ping. And we want to be able to look up, identify meters and outages which no restorations have been received at the associated transformer. So again, if we get outage messages, that's one thing. If we don't get restoration notices, that's another issue where we want to understand what's happening in that neck of the woods. Do we want to proactively do a ping or a load side voltage check? We're building that capability to do that based on the individual customers or all the customers or meters that are associated with a particular trouble order. We also want to be able to look at if we don't get a message from a particular meter and we're wondering what is the status of the meter, and I think this goes to a previous question, what is the status of its neighbors? Did we get a restoration or an outage message from the neighbors' meters or the other meters on the same transformer is really the logic that we use. In which case, okay, that's a little more information that helps us, even though we didn't get information from the particular meter of interest. And again, another previous question is around geospatial representation. So in the top left corner, I have a screenshot of bchydro.com's outage map service for customers. I believe most utilities have something similar to this, where it's driven off of our outage management system, and it shows a rough polygon of where the OMS is predicting the outages. In the bottom left, I have displayed a tool that we're currently using in our field device smart metering operations group to see not only the status of a meter, which could be have thrown a power outage notification exception, but also we can click on those meters or see other graphics around what is the comm rate status of that, what's the read rate over the last X number of days, have we got other events, have we got a tamper event in addition to an outage event, what are the combinations we're interested in, and we can overlay that from our perspective as opposed to number one, which was more of a, I'll call it a fairly vanilla but informative display for customers. And on the right side, number three, that's a visual of our outage management system, where the primary focus obviously is restoration and dispatch and identification of outages, where they can show the status of meter, whether they've got a PON or a PRN. But it's also the tool where it's really the system of engagement for those dispatchers. We have been spending a lot of time recently, now that we've got the data flowing, to understand what's the best way to display that information. And while we may be limited to some extent by the product, there are other things at our disposal, such as moving the columns around to see if a customer show the PRN or the PON for a customer on a trouble ticket. We can sort those in different ways, and that information, if presented efficiently to the dispatcher, can help them make decisions. The other part, decisions we've made is, and I think this came earlier as well, is we did not automate the creation of a trouble order for every PON PRN that came in based on the prediction. We're moving a little slower into that world. We're looking to augment confirmed or at least reasonably confirmed outage notifications from customers and crews and or SCADA and other sources of information that we currently have. But really, until we get a little more experience, automating that process we think would be too much of a risk, both from a dispatcher information overload as well as the higher it would increase the risk of doing a false truck roll. So given all that, on the left I have sort of the assumptions where we started, and really based on that dialogue I just had, where are we now? What have we learned as we went through? So we assumed initially that we would have PONs and PRNs from every meter, or at least most meters. What we've learned along the way is there are so many variables in not only the solution but in the field that we can't really rely on 100%. We get far more restoration messages than we do outage notifications, and I think that would make intuitive sense given the power has been restored, and once the mesh and the network reforms, you can get that information back, versus the hops and the various components of the field as we're finalizing the optimization and deployment of our solution. We get PONs from a number of meters, but not to the same extent as PRNs. The second one was that we would be able to quickly identify outages and make dispatchers more efficient. And as I said before, the PON really tells us the state of the meter, that it has lost power, but doesn't necessarily translate into a distribution system problem that we need to dispatch on. As I said before, we've had storms where cell towers have gone down, so the meters are not communicating. So that's a completely different animal that's not really within our control. The local field office is probably liaising quite a bit with those resources to get that service restored, but from a dispatch or from a smart metering solution, we can't really add much value there until that communications comes back on. We would be able to dispatch to a customer before they even called. I think that's still a noble cause, as I would call it, and I think there's obviously customer service advantages to doing that. But until we have a lot more experience, both with the technology, but also more so with the process integration and the validation rules, I think we need to walk a little bit before we run. And we're also looking at what information do we not only provide to our dispatchers, but to our customer service representatives. And if we provide that information, such as status of a meter, whether we got a PON or PRN, what the status of the other customers on that transformer are, what decisions can they make, or are we willing to have a customer service rep make on behalf of the distribution and restoration process? And second to last year, the integration with our OMS. As I said, you know, the technology integration, while not simple, was relatively straightforward. But initially, we didn't realize how much logic we would want to put into our ESB to help filter and augment the logic that came with our outage management system. And really, most of the logic I talked of previously is in our ESB. And part of that was, A, it gave us a little more control as to what additional layers we want to put in there, as well as how we wanted to configure them. Relatively straightforward to change those configurations and provide that data stream to our OMS without necessarily impacting our OMS during critical times. And we also are making a number of changes, albeit perhaps subtle, to the user interface of our OMS to really augment that customer experience for our dispatchers, I should say, and provide that information in the right context for those dispatchers. And then finally, metering information will be an initial quick win in large storms and broad situational awareness. Well, really, kind of that's kind of the culmination of the previous assumptions. Really, until we understand the behavior, the characteristics, and get a little more experience on the data flows and data volumes and how they translate into actual events versus false positives, we got to be careful around how we interpret that information and what tools we need. We have a number of tools, as I'm sure most utilities do, for presenting both data visually, textually, and geographic context. We need to anchor to some of those both from our field device operations perspective, which is for the metering, for customer service, for dispatch, for all other interested stakeholders. And in that context, for all these assumptions, as I mentioned before, we engaged with a number of utilities and the usual webinars and other information sources to try and figure out what we would do going in. And one of the key things has really been a working group that was formed by Itron with most of its key clients that are using a similar solution to ours. And we get together once a month. And it's a fairly free and open forum where we either talk directly or we can have sidebars, as it were, to talk about what challenges we're having, what experience they're having from a data number of PONs, number of PRNs received versus issued, timing and timestamp issues, all things that are in the really down in the weeds of the solution, which is really where you need to understand this technology to take full advantage of it going forward. Oh, and I think with that, I'll turn it back to Jesse.
Thank you, Ranjan. Great stuff. And that was Ranjan Raja of BC Hydro explaining his lessons learned in integrating AMI and OMS.